An effort to reduce sentences for inmates who've been imprisoned for nonviolent offenses has taken its first step forward. The commutation campaign is working to bring the sentences in line with recent criminal justice reforms that lessened penalties for some offenses. But reformers say that even if inmates are released, efforts must be made to ensure they'll be able to make a successful transition into the community.
Nearly two dozen Oklahoma prison inmates are a step closer to freedom thanks to the efforts of a bipartisan coalition of advocates led by Oklahomans for Criminal Justice Reform. The commutation campaign stems from passage of State Questions 780 and 781, which reduce sentences for nonviolent drug offenders, and other criminal justice reform measures passed during the last legislative session.
We have an alternative between keeping these people incarcerated, separating from their families while we pay all the cost of that, with no public safety threat, or we can have them out as productive taxpaying citizens. And that's what everybody really should want out of the correction system.
Right on Crime Chair Andrew Spino says the campaign looked at hundreds of inmates who'd been convicted of crimes that now carry lesser sentences.
The idea of the commutation campaign is to target inmates who, number one, do not pose a public safety threat, and number two, we have vetted to find that they will make good citizens once they are out.
Sarah Edwards is an attorney with Crow and Dunleavy and a board member with Oklahomans for Criminal Justice Reform. Edwards says a commutation should not be confused with a pardon or parole and does not automatically lead to early release.
It doesn't wipe away the felony conviction. It would still be a felony, but it just lessens the severity of the sentence.
Earlier this week, the board considered commutation applications from a group of 23 inmates, selected out of an initial pool of more than 600 offenders. That number included several women in prison for drug offenses, which are no longer a felony since passage of State Question 780 last year. It also included five inmates who'd been in prison for enabling child abuse, but whose sentences were longer than the male inmates who'd actually abused the children. Edwards says the 23 applicants selected for the commutation campaign had to fit certain criteria.
That there are support systems, family, potential job employment, and treatment ready, once individuals reenter society.
State Pardon and Parole Board member Chris Steele says that was a concern of several board members who expressed reservations about releasing inmates without some kind of supervision.
The gist from the Pardon and Parole Board as they considered these cases was the importance of making sure that if an individual transitions back into the community, there is proper support, accountability, and treatment options available.
Steele noted that several offenders came from counties with programs where substance abuse treatment would be available.
But to be fair, there are certain areas within our state that the services are not adequate or as developed as they should be or we wish that they would be.
Inmates previously had access to programs and training while incarcerated, but with prisons now bursting at the seams, that's no longer the case.
For a long time, the Oklahoma Department of Corrections offered the kind of professional training that people would need to lead productive lives. But as the prison population has exploded, they've simply run out of resources and in many cases run out of space.
Edwards says Oklahomans for Criminal Justice Reform is aware of the problem and will work with successful commutation applicants to ensure that they have access to resources if they are released.
That's job training, it's education, it's substance abuse treatment, it's support. And there are a number of programs, Reemerge, Women in Recovery, that have very high success rates with these wraparound services and support systems.
Programs like Women in Recovery help women to address the roots of the addiction that landed them in prison and make a successful transition back into the community. Nearly 400 women have graduated since the recovery program began 9 years ago, but that still represents only a fraction of the total prison population. Edward says while the numbers for the commutation campaign are small, it represents a significant first step.
I think part of the goal with this program is to show that we can be successful. And the next step and what needs to be done is retroactive application of 780.
The 23 inmates whose applications were approved will come before the Pardon and Parole Board in November for the second stage of their commutation hearings, and their applications would still have to be approved by the governor. The board will also consider a second group of applicants at their next meeting in September.